Okay, it's time to get started. Welcome back, everybody. This is the third and final session on using logistic regression for the analysis of syntactic changes. We covered the most important and the most difficult points last time. So today we just revise, and then all that's left to do is to talk about how to report the model in your final term paper, and also how to do some basic model evaluation. Okay, let's start with some revision. What we wanted to do is analyze the decline in dative experiences in the history of English. And we built a model last time for the time period from the late 14th century to about 1600. The model we built suggested that it's quite a slow change, and it might not actually be the case that dative experiences really disappear with the verb like before about 1750. So what I wanted to do is collect some more data. And that's what I did. I give some examples here in 1, 2, 3, and 4. But that which likes me best, that's a dative experiencer from as late as 1675, or whether him liketh shall be given him. So whatever he likes will be given to him. That's from 1684. And we can contrast those examples with the 1s in 3 and 4. And you must know I like her hugely. I, a nominative, or in 4, Alphonsus, king of Aragon, being demanded what company he liked best. Again, he unambiguously marked for nominative. In figure 1 here, you can see the model we built last time. And now I will show you what happens when you add the additional data, an additional about 60 examples. And you can see that it works beautifully. We constructed a model that sort of seemed to predict the future quite accurately. So again, this is what the model suggested before I added the additional data. And this is what happened once I added the data. Basically, no change to the prediction at all. We would still assume that this takes about 450 years. And like the model we built last time suggests, about 450 years into the change by about 1750, the probability of finding a nominative experience is only 1%. So I spent time on collecting this data. And I also collected data for another verb, namely the verb list. List is largely synonymous with like. They seem to mean more or less the same thing. They mean desire or care or please. But list perhaps has stronger emotions, so a strong desire. List, just like, changes argument realization from a dative to a nominative experiencer, and it became archaic or perhaps died out by the early 19th century. There are some 19th century examples of list, and curiously, they then take the dative experiencers, which seems to suggest that they're used for poetic or archaic effect. It's related to the verb lust. So perhaps that has something to do with its decline, because lust also has strong emotions or sexual connotations, and it's related to the German verb lusten. Also, another fact that's curious about this verb is that it seems to occur without any inflections at all. So even if it's a third person singular pronoun like he or she, you would often just see list, he list, she list, as opposed to he listeth or she listers, which also exists, but it's rare. It reminded me a bit of our discussion of the rise of deontic modality with adverbs like better. So you would say, I had better leave, but nowadays you can just leave out the head and say, I better leave. So better develops verbal properties, but it's always uninflected. So maybe list is a bit like this, in that it is just always this undeclinable form list or lust or lister. And perhaps that has something to do with its decline. Here are a couple of examples. The conservative form in 5. But of that story, list me not to write can be compared with the iterative form in 6. How they make their gain, I list not to describe. So here we have me list changing into I list. Or we can have a minimal pair as in 7 and 8 as her list and as she list. As before, where the experiencer is a noun phrase, where we can't really determine the form, the case, we coded it as ambiguous. So for instance, in 9, we have then Sir Gareth list the well to eat. So then Sir Gareth desired to eat well. That is coded as ambiguous because we can't really tell if Sir Gareth is interpreted as a dative or as a nominative argument. In this way, I added another 336 examples to our data set, and this will now be the final data set. I will show you the data set, what that looks like. Let me just open the file. Okay, so as before, we have the experiencer form, dative, ambiguous, or nominative, the year, and now I added a new variable here, the verb, which is either like for the first 500 or so examples, and then list for another 336 examples. As before, we have this binary variable for the audience, either it's a learned text or a lay people text, the actual text, and a whole bunch of other variables that aren't really immediately relevant for our hypothesis. Does that make sense to everybody? All right, so let's talk about how to report your logistic regression model in the paper. There is no real standardized way. There are different institutions, different departments that give you different guidelines. For instance, in psychology, they have relatively fixed guidelines on how to report statistical models, but in linguistics, it is relatively unconstrained. So here I will just tell you how I would like you to report it, but keep in mind that in later studies or in different papers, you might see different formats. So in order to illustrate the reporting of your model, I would like to answer a different question. And that is there a significant difference in the rates of change for the two verbs that we now have in our data set, like and list? We will simply follow a new script that I made called Data of Experiences Script 2, go through this, and then take the model output from R and transform it into something that you can put into your paper. This is the new script called Data of Experiences 2, and it is exactly the same information as last time, except that I changed the categorical variable from the difference between learned and lay people texts to the difference between the verbs like and list. Okay, so it's the same logic, it's the same mechanisms, it's just that I changed the categorical variable from audience to verb to illustrate what would happen then. First, we load the data and put it into a variable called data. So here we now have 895 observations, and the variable verb is going to be crucial for us. It has the two levels, like or list. As before, we need this library called reshape2 to transform our data frame. So let me just load this library. And now I make two sub data sets, one for like and one for list. So I call this data like, data list, and the two variables will contain only the data for the verbs like and for the verbs list respectively. So I subdivide the data. Then I use the function from reshape2 called dcast to cross-tabulate for every text the number of nominative and dative experiences. First for like. So here's the result. For instance, in Mandible's Travels, we have 5 dative experiences for the verb like, 28 dative experiences in Piers Plowman, and 3 nominative experiences in Piers Plowman, and so on. Then the same for the verb list. For instance, in Mandible's Travels, there are 3 dative experiences for the verb list, and so on and so forth. And now we plot this. First, I plot like. Looks like this. So this is what we already saw last time, but now extended for the 17th century. So all the data points you see after 1600 is what I collected last week. Okay. So that looks really good. That looks like a very nice graph. And you can see how an S-shaped curve might make sense as a model for this development. And now I add the data points for list. And it looks like this. Quite interesting. You might already see just from the data points that they're further to the left, that they're earlier than the points for like. Let's see if this is actually correct, if the change happens faster or earlier for list than for like, by constructing a model for it. So I simply put all of the two verbs like and list into one data frame. And this is the input for my logistic regression model, which I will call log reg verb. So that's a logistic regression model that takes verb as a categorical variable and uses it to predict the frequency of nominative experiences from time, the verb, and their interaction. As you can see here, regress nominative and dative experiences against time, and verb with a star in between. So that automatically puts in the interaction effect as well. Okay. All right, so here we go. Let's see if we can interpret this model here. I'll give you a second to look at this, and hopefully it'll make sense to everybody. Let's maybe start with identifying the reference value and the applied value. The reference value here is the verb like. You know this because the second variable for the verb tells you how the log odds change as you go from like to list. So whatever this word or this label here is, will be the applied value that you change towards. So since you change towards list, your reference value must be like, okay? So let's try to interpret this variable here. Can anybody tell me how you would describe the year variable, for instance, if you had to write it down on your paper? Beautiful. Yes, that's a very good interpretation and well formulated as well. So we could check, we could say nominative experiences for the verb like increase by 0.0195 log odds per year. So if you wanted to put an S-shaped curve in here for the green dots, this would have an increase or a slope of 0.0196. Very good. Now let's try to interpret the last line. How can we interpret this? That's what we talked about last time. That's probably the most crucial bit here in this model. Very good. Yes, that is exactly right. Very good. Yes, as you change from the verb like to the verb list, the rate of change increases. It is faster. It increases by 0.012 log odds, which means the rate of change for the verb like will be this 0.019 plus 0.012, which is about 0.031. In other words, list changes much faster than like. Yeah. So the rate of change is steeper. It is faster for list than for like. If I wanted to put in an S-shaped curve for the red dots, it would have a faster slope, a steeper slope. Let's maybe do it in the regression lines as well using this code here and also a legend. And we end up with this plot. So you can see that the pink line for list is steeper than the green line for like. And then if you look at this model output again, you will see at the end a p-value with two stars, which means that this effect is actually significant. That is to say, list changes significantly faster than like. Let's talk about this line in between. That is probably a bit harder to interpret here, and it is also less important because the interaction effect is more interesting for us. But what this means is if you change from like to list, there's a significant difference in the overall probability of finding nominative experiences. Now you might wonder why this is such a huge number, minus 16. The reason is that this model is scaled with respect to the year zero. So you would have to go on this x-axis here where we say 1400, 1500, 1600 and so on, all the way to the year zero. And by that time, the probability of nominative experiences is vanishingly small for both verbs. It's like 0.00000001%, a tiny, tiny number. But it will be even tinier for list than for like. You can already see this in this plot here by about 1400. You can see how the purple line will fall under the green line. Yeah. So if you extend this model all the way to the year zero, the purple line will be much lower than the green line. And this is what this minus 16 here means. So it's not really ideal. What we probably would want to do for greater interpretability is scale this model to a more plausible year. For instance, we could say that 1500 represents zero, or that 1400 represents zero, and then this minus 16 number would be much larger. What people also like to do is standardize the year variable, and that has also other advantages, especially for more complex models. But for us, for our simple purposes here, that's okay. So don't be worried too much about this big number, minus 16 here. It has to do with the fact that our model goes out to 1400, 1500, 1600, when it has its intercept, its zero point in the year zero. Does that make sense? What I really want you to understand though is this last variable, the interaction between time and verb. So if this is not clear yet, this is a good time to ask me again.
Could you explain it again?
Okay, I will say it again. Yeah, so as you change the categorical variable from your reference value, which is like, to list, the rate of change increases, it's a positive number, plus, by this many log odds. So the rate of change for like is 0.019. This is a rate of change that corresponds to about 450 years for the form to go from 1 to 99%. Now it goes up, it gets faster, it goes up by 0.012. So it will be a much faster change. You then have to simply add this to this to arrive at the rate of change for the applied value for the verb list. In fact, let's now try to calculate how fast this change would be. So here is again the parameters A and B for the verb like. So this is simply taken from the logistic regression output here. This is A and this is B. So I simply put this into the two variables A and B, put it into the logistic function, which I call F. And now you just play around with it until you find the values for 1 and 99%. In this case, those will be the years 1291. Let me show you. F of 1291 is 1%. And the years 1760. So F of 1760 is 99%. Take the difference between the two and we will find it should take 469 years for nominative experiences to go from 1 to 99% for the verb like. Now I do the same thing for the verb list. I simply change the values A and B as shown here. Put this into a new function and try out the new values again. And here I find that list has a probability of 1% of nominative experiences in the year 1315, as you can see here, and 99% in the year 1605. 1605 gives you 99%. It should take only 290 years for nominative experiences to go from 1 to 99% for the verb list. So much, much faster. This, the green line here in this plot takes, what was it, 460 years for the transitional period. The purple line, only 290 years. That's a significant difference. Okay, so now we will try to take the information from R and change it a bit so that it looks professional in your paper. First of all, do not just take a screenshot of R and put it into your paper. I see that sometimes. I don't like this. It's lazy. It looks unprofessional. It doesn't look good. Instead, type up the model and change it slightly. I will now show you how. First of all, in R, you get this line here that says it's a generalized linear model. It has this formula in it, and it tells you where the data comes from. Now, that is useful for your reader. You want to tell your reader what you regressed against what. But this particular line doesn't look very good. So I would just simplify this a bit. And I would leave out this GLM and change some of the names so that they're just simpler and easier to read. Okay, so for the benefit of your reader, change this first line a bit. So for instance, here I say I regress date of experiences against year times verb. That's relatively easy to understand rather than this monstrosity of a strange looking formula here. And also I changed the data. I mean, I want to tell people what sort of data set I used. Of course, in our paper, we only have one data set, but if it's sort of a longer paper or a dissertation, you might have different data sets. And it's helpful to remind your reader what you used. So here I simply say data is state of experience, for instance. So do include this formula, but simplify it, make it look easier and prettier so that your reader can understand it. Now, the second and most important bit is this long list of coefficients. How should we change this? Well, first of all, I would round this a bit. These numbers are much too long. I think for the intercept, it makes sense to just have a single digit. So I change -29.9875917, which nobody really cares about, simply to -29.9. And likewise for the standard error and what is called the Z value. For the rate of change, I quite like to keep a couple of digits because even a small digit here can change the number of years it takes for the change to go to completion quite a bit, right? So 0.015 is quite different from 0.019, will be a difference of several decades. So here I go for four digits. So 0.0196, I think, is a reasonable approximation for the estimated rate of change. Also, I would like you to change this last number, this last label, per greater than Z, simply to a P in italics. This is the conventional way to indicate statistical significance. Okay, so just this lower letter P in italics, that stands for a p-value that indicates statistical significance. And change this smaller than 2e-16.3 stars to smaller than 0.0013 stars. The conventional significance level for very highly significant effects, which are indicated with these three stars, is, as you can see here at the bottom of the description, 0.001. Okay, so that's much easier to read. For the categorical variable, where you change from the reference to the implied value, what I like to use is use an arrow. I think this is relatively easy for the reader to understand, but it is not standard. That's just how I like to do it. So I say, here's my verb variable. And then in brackets, I have like arrow list that is supposed to indicate this is how the log odds change as I switch from the verb like to the verb list. Do you find it intuitive? I think this is quite easy to understand, easier to understand than verbal list. It's the same information. It's just easier to represent like this. Likewise, for the interaction effect, I have here my year verb interaction effect, and I indicate in brackets once again, this is the interaction effect as I change the category from like to list. Yes.
So theoretically, if we change the ground, just theoretically, it means that the list was the first, was the reference verb.
Exactly.
That would be 0.031.
So 0.031. Yes, you would then have a year 0.031 and year minus 0.012. Yes, that would exactly be the output. Yes.
And then my second question. That's the rate of change.
Mm-hmm.
But the rate of change changes over different years.
No, it's constant. Because it's on log odds. So what we have in the graph is a probability, that's an S-shaped curve.
Right.
But on a log odds scale, it's just a line. That's what we talked about in the first tutorial on logistic regression. That's very important. That's why we can have this linear relationship between time and effect on in terms of log odds, not in terms of percentages. Yes?
So here is the rate of change from like.
Yes. Do you think you would want to indicate this in brackets like? We could. So you could say here, year in brackets like, why not? Yeah, I like it actually. It's even clearer for your reader. Also, if this was my paper, it would be quite important for me to have this like list here in the same line. It bothers me that this is below the line, but that's of course just formatting. Just make it look nice and professional. But yeah, I think this arrow here is a good compromise between readability and professionality. Okay, and then at the end, you will get this output about deviance and degrees of freedom. Those should just be copied as they are. Take those and type them up. So I want to see null deviance and then the number here. Again, you can round this a bit. And then on, and then the number of degrees of freedom. In this case, on 116 degrees of freedom. And then residual deviance, in this case, 142 on, and then 113 degrees of freedom. Let me say a few words about this. A good model is one that reduces the deviance from the null deviance to the residual deviance as much as possible. So you want this decline here to be really large. In this case, we go from 583 to 142, which looks pretty good. And you want to get this reduction on as few degrees of freedom as possible. In this case, we get them on only 3 degrees of freedom. So we go from 116 to 113. If I put in more predictors, I have more factors that predict the outcome, obviously the deviance will also go down, but it's not as good if you need many predictors for it. The 3 degrees of freedom that are put into this model are these three lines here, year, verb, and the interaction effect. These three lines correspond to the 3 degrees of freedom that go from 116 to 113, the other degrees of freedom being our individual texts. So you want to decrease, you want to see a large decrease in the deviance here. This is why it's important for the reader to include this statistic as well. Very simple, simply take this from the logistic regression output in R and put it into your paper like this. Okay, there's one last point missing that is very important. And if you don't include it, you will lose some points in your paper. What could that be? A caption. Always, always include a caption for figures, for graphs, for numbers, for tables. Everything needs a caption. In this case, I call it a table. So I say table one and then give it a good description, a good caption. Here I call it a logistic regression model predicting nominative versus stative experiences from time, verb, and their interaction. So for you, this will be from time, audience, and their interaction. Otherwise, it will be identical. You can also call it model one, perhaps, but I like table because it's essentially a table. Right, so this is how I would like you to report the model in your paper. I say a few more words about what you should write. In the results section of your paper, you don't only want to include the table, the model, but also describe it in your own words. So first of all, refer to the model, to the table, and refer to your plot in the main text. I'll give you an example. You could write, for instance, you know, I collected the data, I did this, I modified the data, corrected it, and then eventually you say, and then I regressed the linguistic variable against time, audience, and the interaction between the two. The resulting model is presented in table one. That's the kind of statement I would like to read in your paper. So here's my main text, and it refers to table one, and then here you include table one. That's why you have the caption, like a link, like a shortcut to refer to it. Same with the figure. For instance, you could write, the model is illustrated in figure three, or whatever figure the actual plot will be. Then I also want you to point out explicitly which variables are significant, which variables are not significant, what the rate of change is, and how long the transitional period would be at this rate of change. Those are the bare minimum information to be included in the paper for me to be happy with what you write. Here's an example. You could write, time is a significant predictor in this model. Nominative experiences for the verb like are predicted to increase at a rate of 0.196 log odds per year. At this rate of change, it would take 469 years for the new form to rise from 1 to 99% of use. This is identical, right? So this rate of change is the same as this transitional period. It's just more interpretable for your reader. Then say something about the interaction effect. For instance, the interaction effect between verb and type shows that nominative experiences for the verb list are innovated significantly faster. So I want to see significant somewhere, because in this case it is significant. At a rate of change of 0.0317 log odds per year, implying a transitional period of only 290 years. That's exactly what we just discussed, put into words. So you don't have to use exactly this formulation. Of course, you can probably formulate it better than me. And you would also want to say that there is a significant difference between the verbs like and list, right? So the second line is also significant. And you can include all kinds of other information here as well. But at the minimum, point out what is significant, what isn't significant, and also give the length of the transitional period in years. Very good. Now, for your paper, I believe the interaction effect will not actually be significant. Unfortunately, we will have a negative result. Our beautiful hypothesis that the change should be faster in the vernacular than in non-vernacular texts doesn't seem to be correct. So you should say that there is not enough evidence for this hypothesis. It doesn't necessarily mean that it is false, but it means that the effect could be so small that we can't detect it like this. We couldn't produce enough evidence to suggest that this hypothesis is actually correct. You will build exactly the same model that we just did, report it in the same way, summarize it in the same way, except you have to do it for year audience and their interaction, not for year verb in their interaction. And then hopefully everybody here will produce exactly the same numbers. This will always also make it easier for me to correct. So I just check here the numbers are correct. For the completed data set now, called All Data on Blackboard. So the last thing to talk about is model evaluation. That is usually a big topic, but we will just do a tiny little bit so that you get started on this difficult topic. And that is goodness of fit. Goodness of fit describes the discrepancy between the values that you actually observe, for us, that is individual texts, and the values predicted by the model, for us, that's this regression line. So I hope that makes sense intuitively, but let me just ask a question to make sure everybody understands this. Which of those two models do you think has a better fit? The one on the left side or the one on the right side? Here you can interpret the x-axis as a predictor, for instance, as time, and every diamond-shaped dot here could be an individual text with a certain number of examples. So which of those two models do you think is better? Yeah, exactly, right? The one on the left has a better fit because the data points are closer to the regression line. So that's what we mean by fit. We want to evaluate model fit in some way. There are many different ways of doing this. None of them are particularly good, but in linear regression, maybe some of you know this, there's a value called R squared, which is used standardly. In logistic regression, you can't really use this because we don't use least squares to calculate the fit. But there's something called pseudo R squared measures, and this is what we will be using in our paper. Okay, so let me see if I can explain what that means. Every logistic regression model has associated with it a measure that's called the log likelihood, or LL. If you have a model with a good fit, the log likelihood will be very small. If you have a model with a bad fit, the log likelihood will be very large. So for instance, here on the left, I have an excellent model where all the data points are basically exactly on top of the S-shaped curve. And this will imply a log likelihood of close to zero. On the other hand, the model on the right-hand side here has the data points all over the place. So here the log likelihood will be large. Yeah, so far so good. So log likelihood is a measure that is already used to calculate the fit. So we can use that. The idea is we compare the log likelihood of the regression line to a model that is just a straight line. So instead of putting in an S-shaped model here, I just put in a horizontal line through the model. This is sometimes called a null model. So for instance, here is an actual data set where the orange line is the fitted model. And then I take the overall proportion of the innovative form. In this case, it's quite high. In this case, it's the red line because most of the examples observed are already pretty much at the ceiling. And then compare the orange line to the red line in some way. So what will happen is if I take the null model, and it will have a very large log likelihood because many, many data points won't fit this red line. And then I subtract it from a very good model. So for instance, one that's shown here on the left, which has a log likelihood close to zero, and divide it by the null model, what I will get is a very large value close to one, right? So a large number minus zero divided by the large number will be something close to one. But if I have a bad model with a large log likelihood, then subtracting the null model, a large number, from the bad model, another large number will go close to zero. And dividing it then by the null model will go close to zero. So a large number minus a large number will be close to zero, divided by any other number will be zero. So if your R square value is close to one, it indicates a good model fit. If your R squared value is close to zero, it indicates a bad model fit. That's kind of the logic for these measures. The two models are the same.
Yeah.
The question of whether the fit is good or bad depends on the red dots. Are they actually the actual observed values? Are those close to the S-shaped curve or are they far away from the S-shaped curve? That's what determines a good versus a bad model. Model is actually the same. It depends on the observed values. Yeah, it's maybe confusing to call it a bad model or a good model because it depends on the world. It depends on how forthcoming the universe is with its data. Does it actually fit the model really nicely? Or is it a messy model with lots of interference effects that cause the observed values to be far away from the best fit? Pseudo R square values are very problematic. Mathematically speaking, it is difficult to make this happen, and statisticians have talked about the pseudo R square values a lot. There are at least 10 different values. None of them work perfectly well, and everybody always cautions their use to not be overinterpreted. So we try to approximate the R square value for linear regression in logistic regression with pseudo R squared values, but there are mathematical problems, there are statistical problems, so we cannot overinterpret them. They're one way of estimating fit, there are many others, and you shouldn't just rely on one. We just use this as an example. Let me just repeat this because it's important. The pseudo R square values are not standardized. There's a lot of controversy over which of those many different pseudo R squared value is best. And you cannot overinterpret it. You get a number out, but you cannot just say that proves or shows that it's a good model or a bad model. It is an indication. It is supposed to help you, but there are lots of problems associated with it. We will use a version of the pseudo R squared value called the Nagel-Kirkel pseudo R squared. As I said, there are many different ones. This one, the Nagel-Kirkel pseudo R squared value, that's the one we're going to use. To do this, all you need to do is install another package, which is called FMSB. As before, you only need to do this once. Install packages FMSB, and then you have it installed on your computer. You never need to install it again. Just to run a function from this package FMSB, you need to load the library. So you just type in library FMSB, And then you use this function here, Nagel-Kirke R square on your model. So Nagel-Kirke R square on your logistic regression model. Let me go to R to show you how to do this. So you run this line once, install packages fmsb. Okay, so I actually do need to install this. Oops. All right, then you run library fmsb. And now I simply run Nagel-Kirke on my model. What did I call it? Logreg.verb. Logreg.verb. And I get my value out in this case. Oh, wow, a whopping 0.98. It's a very, very good value. But again, don't overinterpret it. I would like to evaluate the R square value with respect to this table. If the value is larger than 0.5, we can say it's an okay model. It's a good model. Between 2.5 and 0.5, I would say it's average. And smaller than 0.25, I say it's poor. So here I would write something like the Nagel-Kirke pseudo R square value for this model of 0.98 suggests that the model fit is very good. Something like this. Don't make it too strong. Don't use shows, demonstrate, proves that the model fit is okay, or something like this. Suggest or something like this is a better formulation. All right, that basically concludes everything I would like you to know about logistic regression. Well done. You followed this tutorial very well, and I think most of you understood the core concepts really well. I would just like to give you a brief outlook over more advanced topics in logistic regression. So for a third year undergraduate BA course, I think you have a very solid foundation for this. You can do a lot of different things, not only in historical syntax, but in many other areas of linguistics as well, sociolinguistics, computational linguistics, and also elsewhere outside of linguistics. So even if you continue your future studies in a completely different area, logistic regression is a very useful technique to know. But there are many future extensions, and there's much more to know about this, in particular, if you wanted to use this technique for your postgraduate studies. So you would probably have to continue studying this a bit to really become literate with this technique. First of all, I think you should learn how to rescale variables. We saw this just earlier with this large value for the difference between like and list. And in particular, standardizing the year variable is a useful skill. Also, there are many more model evaluation metrics. You can use residual plots or something called the C index in addition to the pseudo R squared values. Another big topic is model selection. In our research, we only have two predictors, time and audience, in their interaction, but very often you have dozens of predictors. And then you have a question, do I want to propose this model or do I want to propose that model? Which variables in their interaction do I want to put in? So it's not uncommon to have a problem about model selection, to select the best possible model. And there are all kinds of different techniques to do this. There are likelihood ratio tests, the AIC value, which you should also report, can be used to compare different models. And nowadays in linguistics, random forests are quite popular to select good models. In particular in sociolinguistics, it has become quite popular. But the single most popular, the single hottest topic in linguistics right now is how to deal with nested data and mixed effects models. So I just want to say a few words about this. Oftentimes, linguistic data is nested. That means that you have one unit of analysis, like individual examples in our case, pooled from larger classes, in our case, from different texts. And different texts or different authors are quite likely to behave similar. Some authors have idiosyncrasies, they have a particular style, they're fond of a particular way of talking. And so ignoring this crucial fact that your individual examples actually come from authors or from texts can mislead you. Here are a couple of examples. Say, for instance, you investigate different students, it might make sense to also consider the fact that they are from different classrooms because they have different teachers or they all hang out together. In psycholinguistics, you might measure different reaction times, but it might be important to consider where you actually measure these reaction times from, because every test item, every stimulus might behave very differently, might have different idiosyncrasies. In sociolinguistics, you might have individual speakers, but it's important that they're actually nested in special social groups. Maybe they all know each other or form a network. And in our case, in historical linguistics, we have all these individual texts forming a year. So our model actually only sees years like 1400, 1422, 1509, but it is possible that one year, say 1599, actually consists of many individual texts. And this information, even though we plot it, is not actually considered by the model. And in order to deal with this, we use mixed effects models. Those include not only the level one predictors, but also random effects for the level two predictors like schools, items, speakers, or years. So mixed effects models, really, let me just say this again, are very popular right now. Everybody talks about them. And in some schools, it is even expected that you use them. So they become standard as well. Here's one simple example from linguistics. On the left side, you have different genders. So we have male and female participants. And the model might see, you know, a difference between them, slight difference. But it is possible that this difference between, say, male and female text is only caused by a handful of speakers. Maybe there are two or three really crazy, very extreme male speakers that pull up the overall regression line. So it is important to consider that these two genders, male and female, are actually made up of individual speakers. They're nested. So this would be one example where it is absolutely important to consider nesting, because otherwise you might overestimate your model fits, or even in some cases come up with completely wrong estimates. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. Thank you so much for your attention. That was brilliant. You suffered through this, but I think it's also really useful and a good technique for the future.